Insulin is secreted by pancreatic beta cells in response to increase in blood glucose level. To explain the mechanism of insulin secretion, we have to know a few basic concepts. As we know, potassium is intracellular ion. This means that the concentration of potassium inside the cell is much higher than concentration of potassium outside the cell. And calcium is extracellular ion, so calcium concentration outside the cell is much higher than inside the cell. Beta cells on their membranes have GLUT1 transporter, ATP-sensitive potassium channels, also they have voltage-gated calcium channels, and they have vesicles that have already formed insulin and C-peptide. We have to know that initially beta cells synthesize preproinsulin, that then is converted to proinsulin, and proinsulin is split by proteolytic enzymes into insulin and C-peptide in a proportional amount. So the amount of C-peptide is proportional to the amount of insulin. It's very high yield to know. So when glucose from the blood enters through a GLUT1 transporter into the beta cells, glucose gets phosphorylated by glucokinase to glucose 6-phosphate, and then glucose 6-phosphate undergo glycolysis with subsequent degradation in Krebs cycle and electron transport chain that results in production of ATP molecules. And it's the central and the most crucial step. First of all, the reason why beta cells have exactly GLUT1 transporter is that exactly this subtype of GLUT transporters transports glucose inside the beta cells in proportional amounts to glucose level in the blood. So for example, for every 10 glucose molecules in the blood, GLUT1 transporter transports 2 glucose molecules. And for every 30 glucose molecules in the blood, GLUT1 transporter transports 6 glucose molecules. So the higher the glucose level in the blood, the higher will be glucose income into the cell. And the major feature that permits glucokinase to work as energy sensor is that the activity of glucokinase is not inhibited by glucose 6-phosphate. Because we have another enzyme that can phosphorylate glucose to glucose 6-phosphate, it's hexokinase, that is present in most tissues. But the problem is that the activity of hexokinase is inhibited by its product, which is glucose 6-phosphate. So only glucokinase can phosphorylate glucose in proportional amount to glucose income into the cell. Basically, if 6 glucose molecules enter into the beta cells, then all 6 glucose molecules will be phosphorylated in the same time. Because in case of hexokinase, this enzyme will phosphorylate 5, and then these 5 glucose 6-phosphate molecules will inhibit hexokinase activity, thereby the last molecule will not be phosphorylated in the same time. And exactly this proportional transportation of glucose by GLUT1 transporter and then proportional phosphorylation by glucokinase permits to produce proportional amount of ATP to glucose blood level. And by amount of ATP produced, beta cells can determine changes in blood glucose level. For example, if for every 10 glucose molecules, GLUT1 transporter transports 2 glucose molecules into the cell, then all 2 glucose molecules get phosphorylated in the same time, and this results in production of, for example, 72 ATP molecules. So let's assume that normal blood glucose level produces 72 ATP molecules per minute. And now cell can determine what is the level of glucose in the blood in various conditions. Because if the amount of ATP per minute decreases to 36 ATP molecules, then blood glucose level is 2 times lower than normal, so we have hypoglycemia. And if the amount of ATP becomes 144, then blood glucose level is 2 times higher than normal, so we have hyperglycemia. So these proportionate features is what makes cells capable to correctly assess blood glucose level by the amount of ATP produced per minute. Also important that if hexokinase have most cells in human body, glucokinase have primarily liver tissue and pancreatic beta and alpha cells. And glucokinase of the beta cells and alpha cells is activated by glucose and is not regulated by insulin. In contrast to liver glucokinase, which is activated primarily by insulin. So it's another feature that makes alpha and beta cells capable to correctly assess blood glucose level. And there are 2 scenarios. If blood glucose level is high, then high amount of glucose enter into the cell, and this results in production of high amount of ATP molecules. And the ATP molecules activate ATP-sensitive potassium channels. With activation, potassium channels close. If potassium channels close, then more positively charged potassium remains in the cell. So membrane potential increase, for example, from -70 to -50, and state when membrane potential becomes more positive, we call depolarization. And cellular depolarization triggers activation of voltage-gated calcium channels. Calcium channels open and calcium by concentration gradient goes into the cell, and increasing intracellular calcium triggers exocytosis of insulin. Both insulin and C-peptide are secreted by exocytosis in proportional amounts, and they are secreted into pancreatic venous blood and then they are delivered into the systemic circulation. Insulin in the circulation increases glucose uptake by the tissues. And the more glucose molecules tissue uptake from the circulation, the lower becomes blood glucose level. And C-peptide is excreted unchanged in the urine. Therefore, the excretion rate of C-peptide can be used to assess and monitor the function of beta cells. Because obviously decreasing C-peptide excretion means that insulin secretion by pancreatic beta cells decrease. If blood glucose level is low, then low amount of glucose enter into the cell. This results in production of low amount of ATP molecules, and now the amount of ATP molecules is insufficient to close potassium channels. And if potassium channels remain in open state, then potassium goes out of the cell by concentration gradient, and decreasing amount of positively charged potassium inside the cell causes decreasing membrane potential. And state when membrane potential becomes more negative, for example from minus 70 membrane potential decreases to minus 80, and this state called hyperpolarization. And in hyperpolarized state, calcium channels cannot be activated, thereby in hyperpolarized state, insulin cannot be secreted. So the main stimuli of insulin secretion is increase in blood glucose level. But also insulin secretion is stimulated by two gastrointestinal hormones, so-called incretins. It's gastric inhibitory peptide, also called glucose-insulinotropic peptide, and glucagon-like peptide. They both stimulate glucose secretion. Very important that in the blood, glucagon-like peptide is degraded by dipeptidyl peptidase 4 that inactivates glucagon-like peptide. And the well-known fact, oral glucose is a more powerful stimulant of insulin secretion than IV glucose. And the reason is that after intake of high carbohydrate meal, for example, oral glucose together with decreasing intestinal pH stimulate intestinal cells to secrete glucose-insulinotropic peptide and glucagon-like peptide that stimulate insulin secretion. And by this mechanism, organism inhibits the rise of blood glucose level after ingestion and absorption of high carbohydrate meals. Also, some amino acids, as arginine, can also be metabolized by the beta cells, and their metabolism results in increasing ATP level and thereby in increasing insulin secretion. And there are two hormones that inhibit insulin secretion. Somatostatin that is secreted by pancreatic delta cells acts on somatostatin receptor on beta cells, and norepinephrine that acts on alpha adrenergic receptors. They both inhibit exocytosis and thereby they both decrease insulin secretion. So how insulin secretion can be affected? First of all, about factors that stimulate insulin secretion. We have a synthetic analog of glucose-insulinotropic peptide, it's exenatide. So exenatide acts on beta cells directly and stimulates insulin secretion. Also, we have drug called sitagliptin. Sitagliptin is inhibitor of dipeptidyl peptidase 4. So when sitagliptin blocks dipeptidyl peptidase 4, degradation of glucagon-like peptide decreases, thereby the level of glucagon-like peptide goes up, and because glucagon-like peptide directly acts on beta cells and stimulates insulin secretion, with increasing glucagon-like peptide level, insulin secretion increases. Also, we have the group of drugs called sulfonylureas that block ATP-sensitive potassium channels. So, after intake of sulfonylureas, they block ATP-sensitive potassium channels, so more potassium ions will stay inside the cell, thereby membrane potential goes up, cell depolarizes, with depolarization calcium channels open, and calcium goes into the cell. Increasing intracellular calcium triggers exocytosis of insulin. Also, hyperkalemia causes increasing insulin secretion. The concept is that with increasing extracellular potassium, potassium concentration gradient decreases, thereby potassium flow through potassium channels decreases, and this causes increasing amount of intracellular potassium. And because now more positively charged ions stay inside the cell, membrane potential goes up and cell depolarizes. With depolarization calcium channels open, Calcium goes into the cell and triggers exocytosis of insulin. In contrast to hyperkalemia, hypokalemia causes decrease in insulin secretion. Because with decreasing extracellular potassium, potassium concentration gradient increase, thereby more potassium ions will leave the cell through potassium channel. This causes decreasing amount of positively charged ions inside the cell, thereby membrane potential decrease and cell hyperpolarize. And in hyperpolarized state, calcium channels cannot be activated, thereby there will be no exocytosis of insulin. Also, we have drugs that can affect insulin secretion. Thiazide diuretics as hydrochlorothiazide that are used in treatment of hypertension stimulate potassium excretion and cause hypokalemia. And as we already said, hypokalemia decreases insulin secretion, and with decreasing insulin level, glucose uptake by the tissues decrease, blood glucose level increase, so exactly because thiazide diuretics increase potassium excretion, they have a side effect, hyperglycemia. Another drug that can affect insulin secretion is diazoxide. Diazoxide usually used in treatment of hypertension, and diazoxide opens potassium channels. And if potassium channels open, potassium leaves the cell by concentration gradient. This causes decreasing amount of a positively charged potassium inside the cell. Thereby, membrane potential goes down, cell hyperpolarized. And in hyperpolarized state, calcium channels cannot be activated. Thereby, insulin release is impossible. So this causes decreasing insulin level in the blood. With decreasing insulin, glucose uptake by the tissues decrease, thereby blood glucose level goes up. And exactly because diazoxide opens potassium channels, diazoxide can be used in treatment of insulin secreting tumors as insulinoma. And also because of this effect, the side effect of diazoxide in treatment of hypertension is hyperkalemia.